okay? So if you have not done yet, please look for me, that I have a part of these declarations, and so we will manage people for here, okay? Thanks.
Thank you. Okay, our last speaker for this early session is Aurelien Crida from the Observatory in Nice to talk about some formations from Saturn's rings.
Thank you very much. Well, first of all, I would like to thank the organizer of the football match because it was a great moment. And I think all the teammates will agree with me that we dedicate the victory of the international team to Jack Lascar's broken collarbone. The talk I'm going to present today is about the formation of Janus and Epimetheus as co-orbitals, thanks to MIMAS's resonances, mainly the 2-3 mean motion resonances. So let me start by introducing the subject, those of you who may not be familiar with it. On this picture, you taken by the Cassini spacecraft, you see the rings of Saturn from above, the outer rings. Mainly if you know them, it's the A ring that is here at the bottom of the picture. Saturn would be at the bottom right, far bit down. And you can not very well see here, but there is the F ring here making a circle, the F ring that Louis Bennett told us about the other day. And the F ring corresponds also to the Roche limit, which separates the region inside the Roche radius in which the tides of Saturn dominate the self-gravity of the ring particles. And this is why the rings still look like rings today, because they cannot aggregate, they are always separated by the tides of Saturn. And outside of the Roche limit, the self-gravity dominates, so you can have spherical bodies like satellites, in particular MIMAS, Enceladus, Titan, and so on. And if you look closely, carefully at this picture, you may notice two dots here that I have put in a square. I'm sorry, the visibility is not great, but I will enlarge these two dots, and they are Janus and Epimetheus. That's the object of this talk. You also may notice on the same picture that Pandora and Prometheus are here around the F-ring. And by eye, you could guess here that Janus and Epimetheus are roughly at the same distance of Saturn. And indeed, they are on the same orbit. And they share the same orbit and the same mean motion around Saturn, so they are in their co-orbitals. And if you look at their motion in a frame rotating with their mean motion, their motion look like the classical horseshoe orbits, and actually both of them experience a horseshoe. So this is the only known system in mutual horseshoe orbits in the universe, I would say, that we know at least of. So it is very peculiar, very important. But we understand more or less the dynamics of the horseshoe, but there are still many problems associated with this. And they mainly come from this torque, the ring torque that was found in the before the 80s when Voyager went to Saturn. There was many studies of the interactions between the satellites and the rings, and the basic result of the gravitational interaction between the satellite and the ring is that the rings transfer angular momentum to the satellite with this rate, gamma, which is proportional to q squared, where q is the satellite to planet mass ratio, proportional to the surface density of the ring sigma, and to the distance to the rings to the power minus 3. If you do the numerical application, assuming a circular orbit, this increase of angular momentum will result in an increase of the orbital distance, of the orbital radius. Following this equation, delta increases with time, with a rate that is proportional to the mass of the satellite and to the distance to the minus 3. If you do a numerical application of this equation to Janus, whom we know the mass, we know the distance, we know the surface density of the ring, you find that about 300 million years ago, delta was zero for Janus. That is, Janus was in the ring. So it shows that Janus cannot be as old as the solar system. This is the first problem. Where does Janus come from then? So let me store this problem on the side, together with the configuration and the torque. And actually, just another problem is that a horseshoe configuration is extremely difficult to reach, to get into. We know that if you have a convergent migration of two bodies, they can be caught in a Lindblad resonance, but not in a co-rotation resonance. You go around the co-rotation resonance. To be caught in a co-rotation resonance, you need the migration speed to decrease. And even so, the window for entering the co-rotation resonance is too small for Janus and Epimetheus. This is a simulation that Marianne did, where you see the semi-major axis going down and going across the resonance, which is shown here. This is the co-rotation angle. You see that we never enter inside the island of resonance. So the second problem is, how could they get in a horseshoe? What's the origin of this situation? And if you look even more closely at the torque, the two satellites feel, you realize that the one that is closer to the rings always feels a stronger torque than when it's outside in the position. And so their orbital separation should shrink. This is not new. This has been found in 85, so 30 years ago, by these very clever people who have calculated that the orbital separation between the two satellites, which is now 50 kilometers or about a third of the Hill radius of Janus, should converge to zero in 20 million years only. And they say that this finding adds an additional number to the list of short timescale problems associated with interactions between Saturn's rings and its inner moons. So that would be the third problem. Why are the two satellites Janus and Epimetheus not already at their neutral L4, L5 points? And are they why do they still have a large orbital separation in this horseshoe dynamics? So with these three problems, you're like, oh my god, what? How is this possible? And yeah, I said, oh my god, indeed, we are here in the former Papal States, close to Viterbo, where there's a beautiful Papal Palace. So you may think, like Napoleon did, talking to Laplace, you know, Newton spoke of God in his book, but I have perused your Mécanique Céleste, so Laplace's book, but failed to find his name even once. Why? And you know probably the classic Laplace answer, I have no need of that hypothesis. I think that Laplace didn't know Janus and Epimetheus. But we are scientists, so it's not about whether or not we need this hypothesis. We do not want to use this unjustified hypothesis. We want to solve the problem just by math and physics. So here is my humble contribution. Let me introduce to you our God-free solution to this problem. We place ourselves in the frame of the satellite formation model developed by Charnoz and collaborators, including me, in which Janus, Epimetheus, and all the regular satellites of Saturn formed from the spreading of the rings beyond the Roche limit. This is sketched here. You have the distance to Saturn here, the rings are in gray, and as the rings do spread because of the interactions between all the ice blocks that constitute the rings, and as the rings spread beyond the Roche limit, then by definition of the Roche limit, self-gravity wins, and the ring ice blocks constitute new moons. These moonlets, then they migrate outward because of this torque, and they slow down as they migrate outwards because the torque depends on the distance to the power minus 3. So they catch up with one another and they merge and they make bigger satellites who keep migrating and merge with another bigger satellite and so on. In this model, as the satellites go away, they grow in mass in a way that we can analytically calculate and that corresponds to the line drawn here in the mass to distance diagram. The mass is the y-axis normalized by the mass of Saturn, and the distance is the distance to the Roche radius normalized to the Roche radius. As you can see, all the regular satellites of Saturn fit very well with the theoretical line. And so we really think that they form this way, and in our model, we start from 0, 0, tiny mass at the edge of the ring, and as you go away, you grow in mass, so the arrow here could represent the time as time goes by. This means that Rhea formed first, maybe even Titan formed first, and they formed in a row, and the last ones are the closest one, so this solves the problem one. This was the object of the paper by Charnoz, Salmon, and myself in 2010. Janus is actually young. We think that Janus just came out of the rings a few hundred million years ago. But also in this frame, you get something else. You get that my mass used to be closer to the ring, because everything is moving away. So if my mass was closer to the ring, its 2-3 mean motion resonance was also closer to the ring. At the present situation, the 2-3 mean motion resonance with my mass is outside of the Roche-Hayes. But it used to be inside it, and this resonance is strong enough to confine the rings and prevent them from spreading, exactly in the same way as the 2-1 mean motion resonance with my mass is now confining the B ring and preventing it to spread into the Cassini division. So there was in the past a moment where the A ring of Saturn was confined by the 2-3 inbound resonance with my mass, and so there was a pause in the formation of the satellite. There was nothing between the rings and my mass. In passing, this nothing may explain very well why now there is nothing between Janus and Epimetheus and my mass, which represents a strong gap in distance and mass, whereas our mechanism should produce a smoother distribution. Now, as my mass recedes, the 2-3 resonance eventually crosses the Roche limit, so the rings are free to spread beyond the Roche limit, and the process of satellite formation starts again, as sketched here in 2. And then we reach the present situation where Janus and Epimetheus went out of the ring, up here now, and they do confine the rings with their with Janus's 6-7 Lindblad resonance, but my mass is 2-3 doesn't play a role anymore. So here we see that when Janus formed, it had my mass's 2-3 Lindblad resonance in the way. What does it imply? Well, inside the 2-3 Lindblad resonance, is the 2-3 co-rotation resonance with my mass. It's inside because of the high excitation of my mass induced by Saturn's J2. And this co-rotation resonance has two capture sites, which can be represented by ellipses here in green in the gray region. And they were full of ring material, of course, because in the ring there are collisions, so you can enter the co-rotation resonance very easily. And now when you pull all this system out of the Roche radius, the ring material that is inside these two co-rotation sites reaches the tight-free region outside of the Roche radius. And then, what does it do? It aggregates, but it aggregates inside this co-orbital site, so it makes two co-orbital satellites on the same orbit. So we solve problem two this way. We think that Janus and Epimetheus did not enter in the horseshoe configuration, but they were formed exactly on the same orbital radius, because of the co-rotation resonances with my mass. The estimated mass we have for the total mass that could be encompassed in the capture site is of the order of 1/1000 of Janus' mass. Now, these two satellites keep migrating outward at the same orbital radius, and they merge with incoming new satellitesimals that form one after another in the ring. And so you can see on this sketch, the satellitesimals catch up with the two co-orbitals, and when they merge, the merger product is, of course, at the middle of the two initial orbits. So this excites the orbital separation of Janus and Epimetheus as they grow, and they are this way. Potentially, we may solve the third problem. Let's have a closer look at this phenomenon. On the figure at the bottom, you see trajectories in the restricted circular free body problem. The yellow region corresponds to circulation, the green region corresponds to libration and horseshoe orbit. And if you are in the red region, that is between 1.77 Hill radius and 2.5 Hill radius, then the trajectory enters in the Hill sphere of the secondary. In the case of Janus and Epimetheus, who formed at the Roche radius, entering the Hill sphere means collision. So this is a forbidden zone for us. So from this, we get that in our process, the two co-orbitals must remain within 1.77 Hill radius, and they merge with a new satellitesimal at 2.5 Hill radius. Then, if they merge at 2.5 Hill radius, the merger product will be at 1.25 Hill radius of the initial mass, but as the mass is now double, the Hill radius is multiplied by 2^1, which is about 1.25. So the merger product is located at one Hill radius of the other co-orbital. Perfect, it's less than 1.77. At the bottom left, you see a picture showing the orbital separation normalized by the Hill radius of three bodies, Two of them start at the same orbit, and another one starts closer to Saturn and migrates faster. So you see the separation goes down. And when it enters the collision region, there is a collision, and the merger product is at 1 h radius, and then the separation decreases. You can see here the semi-major axis as a function of time. This one catches up with the red and the green here, merges with the green, and then the blue, the new blue and red have a horseshoe motion as they migrate away, and you can see the amplitude of the horseshoe decreasing. So this is fine. If you want to extend this, we would need roughly 14 such collisions to have Janus and Epimetheus meet the final mass, because the way this happens is the migration speed is proportional to the mass, so you can only be caught up by a satellite that has exactly the same mass as you, not smaller than you. Therefore, the satellitesimal that is coming and merging with one of the two co-orbitals must have the same mass as the more massive of the co-orbitals. But the more massive of the co-orbitals has less radial excursion, and the smaller one has more radial excursion, so we expect the smaller one to be impacted by the incoming satellitesimal. And so the growth of the two is going to be in the Fibonacci sequence, where you have mass n minus 1 plus mass n makes mass n plus 1. And so if you model this with the mass of the two satellites here shown in green and blue, and the total mass in red, they cross each other like that, every time you have a merger event, you have a kick of 1 h radius separation, and then by time, the orbital separation decreases, as reproduced here. And we can estimate using the mass distance relationship that the damping of this orbital separation is proportional to this expression. The merging occurs every time the time is doubled because you have a constant mass flow from the ring. It's a bit complicated, but believe me, it balances on average to an orbital separation that is about 1.3 h radius. The good thing is it does not converge to orbital separation zero. And neither diverges to orbital separation infinity. There is a balance, and it converges to an orbital separation that is a finite number of h radius. This finite number is 1.3, below 1.77. So this is great, except that it oscillates with an amplitude of 1 h radius around with this 1.3, and so in this little model, sometimes, like very often, we go above 1.77. So I would say it almost works. And in fact, if you do numerical simulations of this process other than this toy model, you realize that it's even harder than that because of satellite-satellite interactions that increase their eccentricity before the collision, which may result in collisions at larger orbital separation in the semi-major axis. Also, the satellites can repel each other if we have too much damping in the eccentricity, and eventually they never collide. So I have to say that I never managed to have a complete simulation where in the end I keep the two co-orbitals for 14 collisions. So this is where we are. To summarize, if we assume that Saturn's regular satellites form from the spreading of the rings beyond the Roche radius, then we find that Janus and Epimetheus are really young, because they are the last ones coming out of the ring, that's for sure. We know that my masses 2 to 3 resonance used to confine the rings, and that's why there's nothing between Janus and Epimetheus and my mass. And we can think that my masses 2 to 3 co-rotation resonance made the creation of 2 co-orbital embryos. And then it gets complicated. So this model solves problems 1 and 2, but our problem 3 is now not the survival of an orbital separation, but the survival of the horseshoe configuration itself, because we would increase the orbital separation too much until the satellite would collide, apparently. So I would say this is still work in progress. The problem is not solved, but I hope this contribution can help, and I hope you like it. So thank you for your attention.
Larger in mass than Epimetheus.
Yes.
Is this hierarchy preserved through your Fibonacci discrete.
Yeah, so
or are there exchanges? And this, can this be tied to the solution of problem T?
So in the Fibonacci sequence toy model we have, of course the mass ratio comes to the golden number, 1.6. And yes, if they exchange regularly, who's the more massive? And at present, the mass ratio between Janus and Epimetheus is 3.2, which is about 2 times the golden number. So I would not be surprised if recently, instead of impacting the less massive satellite, the new incoming one impacted the more massive one by chance, and this made the Janus 3 times more massive than Epimetheus. I don't think this can solve problem 3, unfortunately, but yeah, in this Fibonacci growth model, the mass ratio stays in the order of 1 and could be up to 3 without scandal. So this works great.
So I have 2 short questions, hopefully. So the first one is related to Prometheus and Pandora, whether they are younger or not. And the second one is about the time scale that you get the embryos at in the correlation resonances and that they get ejected.
So for the first question, Prometheus and the Pandora are even younger than Janus and Epimetheus. They formed after Janus and Epimetheus has already gone, but before they can't find the ring. As for the time scale for the formation of these two co-orbitals, I don't know really well. I expect that you need my mass to migrate fast, far enough that the self-gravity really wins to the tides. The Roche limit is quite kind of a fuzzy limit. But things should stay trapped in the co-orbital resonance, like the arcs of Neptune, for instance. So I don't think the time scale really matters. But I can't really answer your question about what the time scale is. Sorry.
Thank you.
Thank you.